What on earth is the Hierarchical Token Bucket, or HTB? If you're committed to mastering RouterOS, you've probably heard this term before, but the odds are it was kind of confusing to you, unless you're also an expert in Linux, particularly when it comes to how Linux kernel handles networking. If you're curious about HTB, then this will be an intellectual journey for you. We're starting in Linux and finishing up in RouterOS with practical examples. It is no secret that the world runs on Linux. Just like a lot of servers are built on it, so are the operating systems of routers. While there are completely custom systems and BSD-based systems, it is safe to say that the majority rely on the Linux kernel. And it is kind of funny that the giants dominating desktop computers are not even a thing when it comes to networking. But anyhow, let's have a look at the Linux internal mechanism for handling quality of service. When you transfer data through an Ethernet interface, the maximum speed is determined at the data link layer. There is a physical hardware bottleneck, and while the network driver might have some very small buffer, it will still be very harsh in the way it drops packets. Quality of service will normally happen higher in the kernel, using CPU resources, and decisions will be made relying on information found higher in the network stack, mostly layer 3 and above. Technically, VLAN tags could be used as well because they contain a 3-bit field called PCP, but your network would have to be specifically configured for that. Most of our switches can actually handle these PCP values at the switch chip level without taxing the CPU, but that is for another video. When it comes to the kernel, it makes a lot of sense to just work with information found in the IP packets. Anything that the firewall could recognize could also be used to trigger a specific QoS treatment. You could prioritize certain IP addresses and ports just to begin with. Furthermore, the IP header contains a special field called DSCP. It is 6 bits large and it can be used to label packet priority with greater precision than a VLAN tag could. The practice of using this IP priority value is called differentiated services, or DiffServe, and it can be set by any application that is doing IP communication. So for example, if you're uploading a file to the cloud with your browser and doing a conference call, then the browser should appropriately set the DSCP values so that the file transfer packets are considered low priority and the conference packets as real-time interactive. First up, your own operating system should take those values into account before transmitting the data. But further down the line, if there are any bottlenecks in the network, those values could come in handy again. It all depends on the situation. An office network administrator might want to configure their equipment to prioritize packets using DSCP, but an internet service provider, on the other hand, might not care at all. Their primary QoS concern is how to divide up their available bandwidth into manageable chunks that they can sell. So there is this DSCP and all this other information in the packets that can tell us what type of data is being carried. The firewall can be used to detect anything specific that we are interested in, and then it can also add packet marks and connection marks. These marks do not modify any data. They're just like post-it notes for your own reference. And they can come in very handy in the Linux subsystem called traffic control. This is where the actual queuing magic happens. If you open up terminal on a Linux machine and type in tc qdisc, it will list your currently deployed queuing disciplines. They are algorithms that determine how your system organizes the flow of packets, especially when they need to be held back in a buffer. The first one I got is no queue, which basically bypasses queuing. On a normal Ethernet interface, if there was any excess traffic, it would be up to the hardware driver to just drop what it can't handle. But this is the loopback device, so it shouldn't be a concern. Then I have several entries with fqcodal. It is a very good algorithm that takes DSCP values into account automatically without requiring any firewall configuration. Currently, it is the default for physical interfaces in Linux. These queuing disciplines are typically applied directly to your physical interfaces, but you can also apply them to virtual interfaces and to what are called intermediary queues. But I won't get into those. What matters is that you are not limited to physical interfaces. You can do logical flows of data too. The range of algorithms that you can choose from is pretty big. Wikipedia lists 28, but I can immediately tell you there is at least one more. The MikroTik PCQ discipline is not listed there. But what you can see in the list is that there are two kinds of algorithms, classless and classful, and HTB is one of them. The most used algorithms are classless, and they are designed to operate with a single queue, usually that of a single interface. To create an entire prioritization hierarchy with multiple queues, you need a classful algorithm such as the hierarchical token bucket. The HTB has a peculiar mechanism for rate limiting. It separates the idea of actual throughput from what is potentially possible and quantifies the potential into tokens. So you get a flow of tokens on one hand and the real data flow on the other. For data to be transmitted or sent further, whatever it's doing, it needs to be matched up with tokens covering equivalent data transfer. When you configure HTB, you work with rates, but it would be more accurate to say that you're working with token rates, and the actual throughput will depend on combination of things, buckets being one of them, but more on that a little later. Let's have a very quick look at the rather complicated configuration that you would need to apply for a basic HTB setup using traffic control. First, you would have to create an HTB root qdisc, in this case using the handle 1. That's like an ID for future reference. Then you would add the main class under the root, and here you can specify a rate. It will be the token flow limit for this whole HTB, and it should not exceed the actual link speed of the physical interface. Then you can add children to this class. It is advisable that their rates add up to the parent rate or less. In this case, we split it 50-50, but it would be okay to set them much lower, as there is also this seal rate, and that one can be set as high as the parent's rate. When one of the classes is not taking up bandwidth, the other class will be able to sustain the full 100 megabit rate. There is also the priority number. It just determines the order at which the child classes receive their tokens. They basically take turns to grab a handful of tokens each. Finally, you have to somehow direct the traffic to the child classes. There are different ways to do it, but in this case, the filters are looking for packet marks 100 and 200. Those would have to be added using firewall mangle rules. Now, if we visualize this HTB setup, it would currently look like this. But of course, we could keep going and add more levels of child classes. The class nodes at the very bottom are considered leaf nodes, and they are the ones that are actually creating queues. The other classes are simply there to regulate token distribution. The interesting thing here is that the leaf nodes can assign their queue to other algorithms. By default, I believe it will be P5O or some variation of first in, first out. But you could pick something else like FQCodel, for example. This combination of HTB leaf nodes with other queuing disciplines deployed is what we refer to as leaf queues in RouterOS. Just remember that it is the leaves that actually handle the packets, and the other layers are just for bandwidth distribution and prioritization. If we visualize this in a simplified way as buckets, it could look something like this. In reality, the proportions are different, but the basic idea is that the tokens flow from top to bottom, and on the way, they fill the buckets, which are reserves to do bursts of traffic. If there are spikes in demand, the buckets can be depleted immediately, but then tokens need to sort of trickle down again to fill the buckets. The actual sustained throughput will depend on the speed at which new tokens are flowing into the buckets. The base flow is determined by the configured rate, but it can be sped up to the ceiling level whenever there are enough tokens in the parent bucket. So overall, HTB is a pretty cool solution that can not only divide the bandwidth into fractions, but it could also allow users to share additional bandwidth and gives them an ability to do little spikes in traffic. That can be very helpful with web traffic on slow connections. You don't want to watch a website load slowly. You would much rather have it load instantly and then take a little break to accumulate more tokens. And on top of that, HTB doesn't limit you to a single algorithm because it can deploy all other queuing disciplines underneath it. Now, but what about the downsides to using HTB? Well, there are several. On slower connections, you might introduce additional latency. The burst behavior might not be consistent enough, and you might not be able to set it up exactly the way you like it. But the biggest hurdle is the configuration. Using the TC in Linux, things can get extremely complex and confusing. For one, data actually flows into two directions. The TC example I showed you only handles the transmit direction because that is where you usually hit the bottleneck of the physical interface. But on a router, managing network resources for other users, you'd have to create at least two HTB hierarchies to handle upload and download limits separately. And then add on top of that all the manual packet marking that I didn't even show you. Things get very complex and it's very easy to misconfigure something. So what should you do about this? Well, just use RouterOS. Not only does it handle all the HTB setup for you in the background, but also the way HTB works in RouterOS is slightly different, which opens up possibilities that wouldn't exist otherwise. Now that we are experts in HTB and Linux traffic control, we can have a look at RouterOS queues and understand them on a different level. Let's start with queue types. This is where you can pre-configure classless queuing disciplines. P5O is kind of the default option and doesn't really do anything. It stands for packet first in, first out. And the only parameter it takes is how many packets it can buffer. FQCODL, on the other hand, is a lot more interesting algorithm, so let's add it as an option for later. Now, the interface queues section is kind of like TC qdisc in Linux. It can apply our pre-configured queue types directly to our interfaces. So if I want Ether 3 to use FQCODL without an HTB layer, I can apply it like so. But to apply HTB directly to a physical interface, you have to use the queue tree section. Here, you can really nerd out and build the perfect queue structure of your dreams. While there are not that many parameters, this is more involved for the user than the simple queue section. Just for a quick demonstration, you first specify your chosen interface as a parent. Then you need a packet mark to direct traffic into this queue. The easy option is to just select no mark. But let me add a new option real quick through the firewall mangle section. Let's say we want to filter for egress UDP packets. By the way, in the queue tree section, you have to control both traffic directions separately, and just like in Linux traffic control, by default, you are working with the egress traffic. Next, since this is our only instance of HTB, we can deploy another queuing discipline. That can be done through the queue type if we want. By default, it is set to the default small, which is a P5O preset. Then the limit add is kind of like the base rate in Linux HTB, and the max limit is like seal rate. But in RouterOS, setting the max is mandatory. If you don't want to use it, you can simply set it to the same value as limit add. The HTB rate control is where RouterOS and Linux start to drift apart. And by the burst settings, we are in a completely different dimension. I won't get into this now. I have everything ready to run a bandwidth test from another router connected to Ether 4. The test is set to receive UDP traffic, and as you can see, the traffic is indeed limited to 20 megabits per second. If we then switch over to TCP traffic and run it again, you can see that now we get close to wire speed. No rate limiting is being applied. Under the hood, with this one queue entry, we created an HTB root instance and an HTB class that then deploys a P5O instance. If we now started to build a hierarchy and added a Q2 underneath Q1, things are going to be changed around automatically. The HTB class would now have another HTB class underneath it, and the P5O at the bottom would now be created by Q2. Remember, it is only the leaves that can actually queue packets. Alright, that was the queue tree in a nutshell. We'll get more in depth on another video. Let's just have a quick look at simple queues and wrap it up. This solution lets you create rate limits for individual IP addresses and entire networks without mandating packet marking. And on top of that, you can work with both traffic directions in a single hierarchy. In the background, things get more complex. HTB is no longer applied directly to physical interfaces, logical layers are used instead, but for the average user, things get more simple. Here is an example simple queue setup. Q1 is applied to an entire network, limiting its upload and download speeds to 100 megabits per second. The two child queues are then applied to individual IP addresses, limiting them to 50 megabits per second. We can then open up two bandwidth tests from the respective client IP addresses and run them. After a couple of quick spikes, the bandwidth test finds upload and download speeds that it can comfortably sustain, right under 50 megabits per second. To make sure that both clients can access the full 100 megabit bandwidth of their parent queue, I can go into the advanced section of both child queues and set the limit at value to 50 megabits, but change the max limit to 100 megabits. This way, when I run a bandwidth test for one of them, it will achieve about 100 megabits per second. But then, when I start the test from the other client, the bandwidth will be immediately reallocated from the first client, so that both of them can again achieve only around 50 megabits per second. It couldn't be more simple. Just enter the addresses and rates and you're good to go. Of course, there are more nuances and best practice advice that you should follow, but all that is for another video. This is already the biggest and probably most complex one I have done here. So I hope you liked, subscribed, and did all the other YouTube things you're supposed to do for your favorite creators.